Disproving a theorem using a counterexample does not seem that difficult, right? Well, it still can be tricky. In this video, we will see an example of a linear algebra question that turned out to be quite difficult for most students. So, what was the question? We had the following theorem. Suppose we have some m times n matrix A, and we know that there exists some B such that Ax is B has infinitely many solutions. Well, then the theorem was, if that is the case, then there also exists a C such that Ax equals C is inconsistent. So is it true or not? And how are we going to prove or disprove it? Well, in fact, the theorem is not true, but let's translate the conditions first. So what does it mean? So we have some matrix A, arbitrary, and for some and that there's some B such that there are infinitely many solutions. Well, that means that you know that A has a free variable, at least one free variable, because if A doesn't have free variables, you won't get infinitely many solutions. So that's what you know. You have some matrix A with free variables. And then you have to prove there's also a C such that Ax is C is inconsistent. So how do you disprove the theorem? How do you prove that it's not correct? Well, then you have to give a counterexample such that you have an A with a free variable or more, doesn't matter, but the matrix A with a free variable. And then in a correct counterexample, there is no C such that Ax is C is inconsistent, that Ax is C can never become inconsistent. The theorem tells you if you have such an A, there will be a C such that you become inconsistent. So counterexample, you have such an A, but Ax is C can never become inconsistent. Well, if you have done this translation step, which may be a bit more of linguistics, then finding the counterexample is relatively easy. You need a with free variables, but Ax and C may never become inconsistent. So you need an A with free variables and a pivot in every row. Now, if you try to find a counterexample, make your A as easy as possible. So put ones and zeros in there to get an easy counterexample. And the easiest I could think of is this one over here. Now, if you are solving your Ax is B, it doesn't matter what B is actually or what C is, you always have your free variable over there, so you have infinitely many solutions. And whatever C is, you will never get Ax is C inconsistent because you have a pivot in the every row of the matrix A. So this constitutes a correct counterexample. Now, why were there so many problems for the students? Well, many used incorrect counterexamples like this A over here. So they picked this A and this B. So you do satisfy the conditions. Ax is B has infinitely many solutions. And then they picked a C like this. And now your Ax is C becomes inconsistent. However, this is not a correct counterexample because you satisfy both the conditions and the conclusion. And in order to have a correct counterexample, you have to satisfy the conditions, but you should not satisfy the conclusion. So you should make an A such that Ax and C can never become inconsistent, so this A won't work. And so this is an example of an incorrect counterexample. Now, with the same matrix and the same B and C, students try to prove that the theorem is true. So then they said, okay, we have an A and a B and a C. We satisfy the condition of the theorem. We satisfy the conclusion of the theorem. So the theorem is true. However, you have to show this for that if the theorem holds in your opinion, you have to show that this holds for all matrices A. So you can never prove that the theorem is true giving a single example that happens to satisfy the theorem. So trying to prove the theorem like this is also incorrect. Of course, the theorem is not true, so you cannot prove that it is true. But apart from that, if you try to prove a theorem, if you try to prove that the theorem is true, then you cannot just give one example that happens to satisfy the theorem.